Well, hello to you all, and a very warm welcome to St John's Church, Bellbridge. This is our online live stream service. I'm Mark, the vicar here, and we're really, really pleased to have you with us today. It's been a real scorcher this weekend. It's pretty hot out there already. So I hope you find the service today refreshing. Not physically refreshing, of course. You can get the paddling pool out later for that. But I hope spiritually refreshing as we hear from God's word, as we sing his praise together, and as we talk to him in prayer. Well, let me mention, particularly as we start, the children's activities that are available to download from our church website alongside of our services. There's a resources for kids button on the front page of the website. And particularly in August, there are chat mats available. I think I've got one on the screen, so you can have a look at what these are all about. There's a number of these that you can download, so there's plenty to keep you going over the coming weeks. And these are a great opportunity, really, as a family, to be doing stuff to teach your children about the things that Jesus said and did. So you can download the mat. There's things for the children to do as they work through the activities and questions and colouring them in. And then questions for you to discuss together as a family, and suggestions about things to then pray for. So these are fantastic things to do, particularly in this time when our children's groups haven't been meeting. A great way for our parents' families to be teaching their children about Jesus at home. Of course, hopefully many are aware now that plans are in place for the Rock, our children's groups, to restart from September. But in the meantime, do make the most of these fantastic chat mats. Well, let's begin with an opening verse. We're going to take a verse from Psalm 26, verse 12. Let me put it up on the screen. Last week, as we thought about Jesus walking on the water, we saw how he was the one who led his disciples from the treacherous waters of the stormy sea to the safety and the solid ground of the shore. So we begin with this verse. Now I stand on solid ground, and I will publicly praise the Lord. Well, we're going to praise the Lord as we sing now together. If you want it to be publicly praising the Lord, do fling wide open your windows and sing at the top of your voice so friends and neighbours out in their gardens this morning can hear us praising the Lord together. We're going to sing This Is Amazing Grace. The grace speaks about all that God has done for us in sending his Son. And when it talks about the Lamb who was slain in this song, well, that's referring to Jesus and his sacrifice, his death for us. Shall we sing? Thank you. Well, shall we have our mini quiz at this point in the service to introduce the theme of the Bible teaching? This quiz this week is going to be quite specific knowledge, and maybe any of our younger watchers, children and young people, might have an advantage over some of our older watchers. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put an image from Toy Story up on the screen, and there's 9 different characters from Toy Story in this image. I'm going to give you 30 seconds. You might recognize the characters, but how many can you name? Can you name all 9 of them? Well, that's time, I'm afraid. How did you get on? Did you manage to get all 9 of them? Maybe somewhere close. Maybe you got 1 or 2. Let me give you the answers. You can see how you got on. The 9 characters here in the picture are Woody, Jesse, Buzz Lightyear, Rex, the aliens, Slinky Dog, Woody's horse Bullseye, and Mr. and Mrs. Potato Head. Congratulations if you got them all. Well, before we have our Bible reading with today's passage, I want to say a little bit by way of introduction to John chapter 7. That's where we've got to, and those who have been joining us for the live streams over the last few months will know that we've been teaching through the book of John in the Bible, and the purpose of this is really so that we get to know the book really well. It encourages and strengthens our faith, but also so we're able to share it with others, and we're going to be coming back to John over the course of the next year or so, so that we get to know it really well. By my calculations, we're about a third of the way through the book. We're at chapter 7, and in August, myself, Luke, and Tim are going to be giving the talks from this chapter. But one of the standout features of John chapter 7 is that we meet a whole range of different characters, all with different opinions about who Jesus is. That's the tenuous link back to our quiz from Toy Story with the different characters from that film. Chapter 7, we meet different characters, all with a range of different opinions about Jesus. You might want to have a read through this week, see if you can spot some of the different opinions that we find in this chapter. But I'm just going to quickly run through a number of them now so you can see what I mean, as we see the different reactions that people had to Jesus in this chapter. I think I've even got them up next to me. There we go. So verse 1, we first of all meet the religious leaders who want Jesus dead. Verse 5, even his brothers do not believe in him. Verse 12, some think he's a good man, others think he's a con man. Verse 15, whether we discover that the crowds are amazed at his teaching. Verse 20, they say he's demon-possessed. Verse 31, now many people believe. Verse 40, he's the prophet. Verse 41, he's the Messiah or not. And then verses 43 and 44 sum it up quite nicely for us. Thus the people were divided because of Jesus. Some wanted to seize him, but no one laid a hand on him. And as the chapter closes in that last section, 45 to 52, we meet the temple guards who are impressed by Jesus. We meet the Pharisees who are angry. And Nicodemus, who seems to be sticking up for Jesus. There were a whole range of characters with a whole number of different opinions. And Jesus certainly divided opinion then, just like he does today. I was trying to think, what are the times where I've experienced or seen this range of opinions most clearly, most obviously? And I thought back to a time when I was a student. I was at Durham University. And I was part of the Christian Union there. And we ran a week of events encourage people to look in to the claims of Christianity, the claims of Jesus. And one of the things we did as part of this week of events is we got a whole load of John's Gospels and gave a copy of John's Gospel to every single student at the university. Well, I had my pile to give out to the people that I knew. And as I went around giving these out to people, whether knocking on their doors or in the bar or the dining hall, wherever, there was a whole range of different reactions from people. I think probably the most overwhelming, the most popular reaction was polite acceptance, but it was clear there was not really any interest. And I imagine those John Goths have probably got buried under the stack of course books on people's desks or disappeared underneath the toasty maker in their room. Some reacted like that. Some, however, were interested and wanted to find out more and came to other things that were going on during the week of events. A few people believed, but I also experienced there was some opposition, some who were quite opposed to this. So one guy in particular, he was a guy who was quite a good friend, actually, and we've stayed in touch. But he was really upset and angry that I would offer him a John's Gospel, and he threw it back in my face and was really upset by this. There was some opposition. And actually, one of the things I remember as well, that during this week of events, we called it Breakthrough, and all the branding and the logo was linked into this name. It was picked up on the idea that the testimony of those of us that were Christians were that when we came to believe in Jesus, it was a real breakthrough moment for us. But all the branding was around this idea of breakthrough, and someone in our college decided to run an alternative campaign and have advertising alongside this. They used all of our branding and the same logo. But they called their campaign, instead of Breakthrough, they called it Break Wind. It was actually quite funny. But nothing else provokes that kind of opposition as they ran this campaign to mock all that we were doing. Jesus divided opinion just as much today as he did then. Well, John, as he writes his book of the Bible, in his introductory chapter, told us to expect this. Chapter 1, verses 11 and 12, we're told Jesus came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Can you see? Some will believe and receive him, others will not and will reject him. Well, I just want you to imagine this. Imagine that you were looking for a panel for a question time discussion about the identity of Jesus. I wonder if the pool of characters that we meet in John chapter 7, that you could draw from that pool to form a really, really good question time panel discussion on this topic, because you've got such a range and diversity of opinions. You'd get one of Jesus' brothers, you get one of the Pharisees, you get one of the crowds, one of the temple guards, so you probably have Nicodemus on there. And with a range and diversity of opinions, it would lead to a really, really good discussion. But I want to ask us this question. If you were on that panel, that question time panel, about the identity of Jesus, with all that we've been seeing about Jesus in John, and with all that you know about him, well, what position would you be arguing for about who he is? What would you be arguing for him? And would there be substance behind your arguments? Would it be well thought through, good reasoning to back it up? What position would you be arguing for? You know, if it really does matter what we make of Jesus, and John says it does, he says eternal life is at stake. Let me just say that again, because I think sometimes we pass over that phrase all too quickly without hearing the significance of it. Eternal life is what's at stake. It really does matter what we make of Jesus, whether we believe in him. Well, what position would you be arguing for when it comes to his identity, to who he is? Well, we're going to come and look specifically at the first section of John chapter 7. Arno is going to read that for us in just a minute, so you might want to have Bibles open. I'm going to lead us in a prayer as we come to think about this together, so let's pray. So Heavenly Father, we give you great thanks once again for the truth of your word that we find in the Bible. Thank you for the privilege of being able to have it open before us in our own language. And as we look at this passage from John chapter 7, Lord, would we hear your voice, Lord? Would you speak to us through these words? Lord, take these words and by the power of your Spirit, just help us to believe the truth of them and to seal that truth in our lives. Amen. So John chapter 7, we're going to read 1 to 24, and Arno is going to read that for us.
It's John 7, from verse 1 to 24. After this, Jesus went around in Galilee, He did not want to go about in Judea because the Jewish leaders there were looking for a way to kill him. But when the Jewish festival of Tabernacles was near, Jesus' brothers said to him, "Leave Galilee and go to Judea, so that your disciples there may see the works you do. No one who wants to become a public figure acts in secret. Since you are doing these things, show yourself to the world." For even his own brothers did not believe in him. Therefore Jesus told them, "My time is not yet here. For you, any time will do. The world cannot hate you, but it hates me because I testify that its works are evil. You go to the festival. I am not going up to this festival because my time has not yet fully come." After he said this, he stayed in Galilee. However, after his brothers had left for the festival, he went also, not publicly, but in secret. Now, at the festival, the Jewish leaders were watching for Jesus and asking, "Where is he?" Among the crowds, there was widespread whispering about him. Some said, "He is a good man." Others replied, "No, he deceives the people." But no one would say anything publicly about him for fear of the leaders. Not until halfway through the festival did Jesus go up to the temple courts and begin to teach. The Jews there were amazed and asked, "How did this man get such learning without having been taught?" Jesus answered, "My teaching is not my own. It comes from the one who sent me. Anyone who chooses to do the will of God will find out whether my teaching comes from God or whether I speak on my own. Whoever speaks on their own does so to gain personal glory. But he who seeks the glory of the one who sent him is a man of truth. There is nothing false about him. Has not Moses given you the law? Yet no, not one of you keeps the law. Why are you trying to kill me?" "You are demon-possessed," the crowd answered. "Who is trying to kill you?" Jesus said to them, "I did one miracle, and you are all amazed. Yet, because Moses gave you circumcision, though actually it did not come from Moses but from the patriarchs, you circumcise a boy on the Sabbath. Now, if a boy can be circumcised on the Sabbath so that the law of Moses may not be broken, why are you angry with me for healing a man's whole body on the Sabbath? Stop judging by mere appearances, but instead judge correctly." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, thank you very much, Arno. There's something attractive about people who have the courage to stand up for what's right, even if they know it's going to make them unpopular. Here's my favourite example of someone like this. It's called Coach Carter. He features in the film of the same name. You may not have heard of him. It wasn't particularly a big film. He's obviously not a real person. But I love the film and find it really, really inspiring because Coach Carter had a philosophy, as he was a basketball coach in quite a deprived area, that the guys who played on his team had to be attaining certain grades at school in order to continue to play and for the team to continue. And it worked for a while, but as their grades started to slip and they started failing at school, well, Coach Carter closed down the team and he shut the gym. And there was a tremendous opposition to this. It was an extremely unpopular move, not just from the guys on his team, but their parents, in fact, the whole community. And he comes under immense pressure to reverse the decision and change what he knows is right. But he sticks by it because he knows and believes that this is the right thing for the young people, for those lads on his basketball team. Well, I guess the flip side to someone like Coach Carter is maybe someone who could be described like a bit like a chameleon, someone who changes depending on who they're with, changes their views and their values to fit in and to blend in with others, or someone who changes so that they are meeting what other people expect of them, or even someone who changes in order to fit in with what are the most trendy ideas of our culture at the moment. Well, what about you? Where do you come? Are you more like Coach Carter or more like a chameleon fitting in and blending in? Just going to put a visual up on the screen. There it is. Where do you sit on this line between someone who goes along, tends to go along with whatever is most acceptable to others, and someone who tends to stick to what you know is right, no matter what others may think of you. Let me just add a couple of layers to that as well, particularly maybe viewing this for those who are Christians. The difference between us wanting to please people and wanting to please God. Or also, the difference between looking for personal glory in life and looking for God's glory. So just have a think for a moment. Where would you put yourself on that line? Which side of those two extremes do you lean towards? Well, my favourite real example of the right-hand side of that diagram, Coach Carter, of course, just a fictional character. My favourite real example is Jesus, and particularly when we meet him in John chapter 7. Did you notice as that passage opened, we met Jesus' brothers? Jesus had four brothers, as far as we're aware. They were younger than him. He would have also had sisters as well. James is probably the most famous of Jesus' brothers, and he's written one of the books of the Bible. And as we meet Jesus' brothers, well, on one level, they're supportive of him. They seem to want what's best, but on another level, they just don't get it. So verse 5, even his own brothers did not believe in him. They do come to believe at a later stage, but at this stage, we don't. So just to sort of set the scene a little bit as we meet Jesus' brothers, what has happened in chapter 6 is Jesus' popularity has taken a nosedive. Do you remember from previous weeks, he was really popular after the spectacular sign of feeding 5,000. But then following on from that, his unwavering teaching about what that meant, well, many people reacted, this is too hard for us. And they left him. They turned away. And by the end of the chapter 6, we've gone from 5,000 down to just 12. And even one of those, we're told, is going to betray him. And so in the face of this, at the start of chapter 7, his popularity has taken a hit. Jesus' brothers say to him, Jesus, we've got a great idea. Have a look in verses 3 and 4. Basically, they say to him, Jesus, go where the crowds are and give them what they want. The crowds were all gathering in Jerusalem at that time. It was the Feast of Tabernacles. There were masses gathering there. So his brothers say, that's where you should go. That's where the people are. And give them what they want. Well, it was the signs, the spectacular miracles that made Jesus popular. And they're saying, do more of those. So verse 3, leave Galilee, go to Judea. That's where the festival is. So your disciples may see the works that you do. They go on to say, no one who wants to become a public figure acts in secret. Since you are doing these things, show yourself to the world. Well, how is Jesus going to respond to this? Will he take their advice? Will he do what he knows will make him popular? Or will he do what he knows is right? Well, we're going to see that for Jesus, it's not about what's popular, and it's all about what's right. Let me just point out from chapter 7, verse 1, actually, before we move on, because you'll have noticed that sentence at the start. After this, Jesus went around in Galilee. That actually covers a period of probably around 6 months' time. And some of the other gospel writers have told us in detail about some of the things Jesus did during that time. But John skips straight over that without giving us the details and straight into this theme of Jesus' popularity in chapter 7. And I think he wants us to closely connect chapter 6, where his popularity nosedive, to chapter 7, where the brothers are saying, come on, we've got an idea to get your opinion poll ratings back up there once again. And will Jesus do what is popular or what is right? Well, what about me? What about you? In our lives, do we tend to go for what will make us popular? Or do we tend to go for what is right? I think this is a really important message for the church. I think we often seem to think that our role as a church is to do whatever is going to make us most popular with the biggest number of people. Whereas actually, our job is to be a voice for the truth, to take the truth that God has made known in his word, and for us to help to make that known to the world, whether or not that draws a crowd. Important message for the church. I think this is also a really important message for young people. A lot is made of peer pressure for our younger people, and rightly so. It's a big deal and can be really hard for youngsters as they're growing up. So for young people, well, will you have the courage to do what is right, even if it may not necessarily make you popular? I think this is a really important message at work. In the workplace environment, different professions face all sorts of challenges day by day about whether we go for the option that makes us most popular, most successful, or whether we do what is right, even if that doesn't lead to popularity and success, career progression, all of this. And of course, this is an important message for all of us in all sorts of ways. I think we may be all familiar with the temptation to be people pleasers, to be overly controlled by what others think and their opinion of us, to be those who are kind of craving approval of others or the praise of others. I know I see this in myself. Whoever that might be from, it can be really liberating and releasing to be set free from that, to do what is right before God. And what other people think, well, that's up to them. I just want to read to you a couple of questions that Ed Welch proposes in this book, When People Are Big and God Is Small, because it picks up on this idea. And he just asks these three questions at the end of his introduction. Why is it that I need others to think highly of me in order to feel good about myself? Second question, why do I allow what others think of me to become so much more important than what God thinks? And third question, in my relationships, why do I need other people and what they give me more than I love other people and what I can give to them? Will we do what is right before God and what other people think? Well, that is up to them. So coming back to John chapter 7, let's have a look at how Jesus responds to this great idea from his brothers to do what is popular, to go where the crowds are, and to give people what they want. Verse 6, Jesus told them, "My time is not yet here, for you any time will do." His time in John refers to the hour, the time of his death. And so he's saying, when I do go publicly to Jerusalem, well, it's not going to be for popularity. It's not going to be for personal glory, but that's going to be my hour. That's going to be the time when I go to sacrifice myself for the world. Verse 7, the world cannot hate you, but it hates me because I testify that its works are evil. You see, Jesus, when he came to earth, was not expecting to be popular. Now, his message about sin and salvation, well, it wasn't well received on the whole. He was even, as we read in this verse, hated for it. And then in verse 10, well, having said he won't go up, he does actually go up. But the point is, he doesn't go in the way his brothers want. Not to draw a crowd, not in public. But we read he goes not publicly, but in secret. See, for Jesus, it's not about drawing a crowd. It's not about going with a fanfare. You know, in chapter 7, there's no spectacular signs in this chapter. Jesus doesn't go and give people what they want in that respect. But he continues to take every opportunity to teach the truth. Not about drawing a crowd and spectacular signs, but he goes in secret and to teach the truth. Well, I think then what Jesus says in verse 18, I think he makes it really, really clear. He's responding here to a question that the crowds have asked. In verse 15, how did this man get such learning without having been taught? And as he responds immediately, he wants to say, my teaching's not my own. And he points to his Father in heaven. He says to people, look, if you make that decision to do the will of God, to believe in me, well, you'll discover the truth of that as you do so. And then he says in verse 18, whoever speaks on their own does so to gain personal glory, but he who seeks the glory of the one who sent him is a man of truth. There is nothing false about him. Can you see the contrast? Whether you're about gaining personal glory, the praise of others, or whether you seek to be a person of truth, of whom there is nothing false. But for Jesus, it wasn't about that personal glory. It was about being a man of truth as he seeks the glory of his Father, whether or not that makes him popular. And we see in chapter 7, don't we, how opinions about him are divided. So let me just put our little diagram up on the screen once again. I just want you to ask the question this time, where does Jesus sit on this line? Having seen what we've seen in chapter 7, where would you put Jesus? And having thought about that, how close is where Jesus is on this line? How close is it to where you would put yourself? Jesus as an example is a real inspiration to us. He was wanting not to please people, but to please God. Not looking for personal glory, but for God's glory. Will we do the same? Well, let me give one illustration and then two quotes. And the illustration is for a lady who's an older lady at the latter stages of her life. And actually, in her life, she's achieved and done remarkable things for God in many ways and in many places. But she never really received much credit for that, never really got much acknowledgement for the things that she'd done. In fact, nowadays, people aren't even aware, really, of the sorts of things that she's done for the Lord in her life. But as she looks back on her life, well, she is content just to be able to say, I have been faithful to God. At every stage, I have done what is right in his eyes. And that is all that matters. I don't know about you, I think that's liberating to be able to have that attitude to all that we do in life, not for personal glory, but for God's glory, not for the praise of others, but for the praise of God. Here's J.C. Ryle, the former Bishop of Liverpool. Let us never be ashamed to be of that small number who believe in Jesus, hear his voice, follow him, and confess him before others. And then this gentleman here, Albus Dumbledore, always has a wise thing or two to say. He said this, there comes a time when we must choose between what is easy and what is right. Shall I pray? So, Father, we want to thank you for Jesus' example and the example of others we know. Lord, not rushing after what is popular, what would make him popular, but doing what is right in your eyes. Give us that same attitude, that same approach to life, we pray, that we would be set free from seeking, depending on the approval and the praise of others, and would be content to know that we are faithful to you, doing what is right before you at every step of the journey. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we're going to lead into a time to pray now. We're going to do that by singing The Lord's My Shepherd, and Leo and Rachel will lead us as we sing.
The Lord's my shepherd, the Lord's God. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still waters. His goodness restores my soul, and I will trust in you alone. And I will trust in you alone. For your endless mercy follows me. Your goodness guides my ways in righteousness, and he anoints my head with oil, and my cup it overflows with joy. I feast on his good delights, and I will trust in you. Trust in you alone, for your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me home. And though I walk the darkest path, I will not fear the
I'm just going to give you all a moment or two to pray now in your homes. I'll put some suggestions of things you might like to pray for up on the screen, particularly on the lines of saying thank you to God, saying sorry to God, and saying please, asking him for things in our nation and in our particular community. So some suggestions on the screen. Feel free to use those if that's helpful, if you have an opportunity now to talk to God in prayer. Could I invite you to join in together with the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Well, just to make sure that everybody is up to date with what's going on at the moment, let me run through one or two things. Our 6 p.m. service meets in church again this evening. Very much looking forward to that once again. It went well for our first one back last week. And we continue to meet at 6 o'clock. Don't forget to book ahead for those that want to come. And for those who have booked in for this evening, remember to bring yourself, your Bible, and your face masks. And for those who want to come next week, future weeks, do get booked up. Christianity Explored again got off to a good start on Tuesday evening this week and continues this coming Tuesday at 8 o'clock, being run virtually. Phil and Rosemary Tabman can give you more details on that. If you would like it. And our church will be open on Wednesday mornings, 10 to 12 throughout August, not on Saturday mornings this month, as we're meeting back in church on a Sunday now, but the open church on Wednesday morning. This next weekend as well, there's a youth kayaking event. That's on a Saturday. Tim Dulloway can give more details if you haven't received the information about that. And then just to let you know, we're continuing to do communion virtually during this time. That will be next Sunday at 11 o'clock after our live stream on Zoom for those who want to join us. And if you've been receiving the email updates or checking the website, you should be aware that from September, our youth and children's groups are going to be reopening, meeting together once again in the church. And our 10 o'clock service, we're also going to add that into the things that we're able to do. That will both be in church and also broadcast online as well for those who are unable to be there. So hopefully that's got you up to date. But as usual, if there's anything you're uncertain about or any questions about what's going on, please don't hesitate to get in touch. Well, let's use the words of an affirmation of faith before we close our service. This is an opportunity for us to declare together what we believe, to encourage us to stand firm in the things that we believe. This one particularly is about our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. I quite like having an affirmation at the end of the service because it reminds us that these are things not just that we believe in our heads or our hearts, but we seek to live out and put them into practice as we go about our lives. The words on the screen, do join in. Let us affirm our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing. Taking the form of a slave, he was born in human likeness. He humbled himself and was obedient to death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has raised him on high and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us today. Same time next week, Luke's going to be giving the talk on the next bit of John chapter 7, and we'll be meeting some more of the characters that are such a feature of that chapter of the Bible. Well, I'm going to close us in prayer now using words from Hebrews 13, and then we'll say out loud the words of the grace together to finish. So now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, may he equip us with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever. Amen. And now together, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forever. Amen.